I'm Mark Pitchers, fishery owner, consultant and carp freak.
Double bubble.
Big pits, tiny ponds, day tickets, club lake syndicates, I've fished them all.
Let's turn up for the books.
I love the peace, the tranquility, the anticipation and the thrill of the chase. But ultimately, it boils down to one thing, a carp in the bottom of a landing net.
High five.
I've been the traveller in Crafty Carper. I'm now the face of Total Carp's 20s challenge, so I certainly know a thing or two about catching carp under pressure.
But I now face my toughest challenge yet.
Carp fishing missions set by you
on Fox's Facebook page.
And once the guys at Fox select that challenge, I have no option but to accept. Can I do it? Yeah.
Oh, we've got him. Yes.
This is the challenge.
What's up, carp freaks, and welcome to my fifth challenge. When we asked you to write in with your suggestions, I don't think in our wildest dreams we anticipated this sort of response. Over 1,100 of you wrote in, and the suggestions varied from the sublime to the ridiculous. We had Ross Dutton, he wrote in, wanting to know, how many boilies can I get up my bum? Well, Ross, that sort of information is strictly between myself and Harry the cameraman. Stephen Wade, he wanted me to catch a 20-pound carp on bait only from a supermarket. Well, Stephen, if you check out part four of the challenge, I think you'll enjoy watching that one. But the challenge we went for was from Daniel Howard, and he suggested the Bait Bucket Roulette Challenge. Several bait buckets, and I've got to choose just one. One of them has pop-ups inside, one with bottom baits and one with naturals. Whichever bucket is chosen, I can only use items from that bucket, even if it's for building up the swim. So if I get the one with the pop-ups in, I'm pretty much screwed. He also adds, I've got to catch a brace of 20s. So yeah, it's gonna be a tough one. The venue Fox have chosen for me is Stanwick Lakes in Northamptonshire. There's a few lakes on site, but they've chosen Mallard Lake. It's well stocked, plenty of double figure fish, quite a few 20s, but selecting the 20s from the doubles is going to be quite a tall ask, especially when we've only got little more than 24 hours on site. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to waste no more time, I'm going to barrow my kit down to the lake, and then we'll have a go with this bait bucket lucky dip. So this is the swim that I've chosen, and as you can see, I've got this area of nice calm water in front of me that's sheltered from this really strong wind. And I say really strong wind, it is strong as well. It's the tail end of a hurricane that's meant to sweep over the country in the next 24 hours. And the wind is meant to really pick up. Severe gales are forecast along with torrential rain. So not only will this sheltered area give me a little bit of shelter and protection, also, I can't really see the carp being on the end of this wind. It is cold, it has got a bite to it, so I don't think they're going to be on the end of it. And like I say, with it being a little bit more calm and sheltered, it allowed me to bait up a lot more accurately and fish a lot more effectively and efficiently, really. So I think all there is to do now is, Harry, show me the buckets. Well, this is a selection of baits that have been provided for me to make up each package. For the boilies, we have about 4 or 5 kilos of baits here. This is a mixture of cell and hybrid. I've got some 10 mil hybrid here, and I've got the 15 mil cell and hybrid all mixed in. And I think this package probably would present me with the best chance of passing this challenge. There are quite a lot of double figure fish in here. And I think for me to try and select the bigger fish, select them 20 pounders, I think an out and out boilie approach would give me the best possible chance of getting them bigger fish. Then we have some maggots here. There's 2 gallon of maggots, mixture of red and white, and I've also got a pot of worms. I can mention that there are a large number of double figure fish in here, and I think this sort of feeding approach is likely to attract more fish into the area, possibly of a smaller average size. And I think selecting the 20 pounders or the two 20 pounders to pass it, I think could be a big ask with the maggots. Then we have the pop-ups. I've got some dumbbells, some 15 mil pop-ups here. There's some green, pink and white. And it basically, it's single hook bait fishing, which does become a bit of a lottery. I could get a take, it could be a 20 pounder or it could be a bream, who knows. So that's it, that's the selection. What I'm gonna do now, I'm gonna hand this little lot over to Harry. He's gonna put them in these black buckets and then we will play Bait Bucket Roulette. Well, here we go. This is the moment that will define the rest of this session. We'll try and sniff out the boilies, I think. Can I pick them up? Feel them? Jiggle them? Give me a jiggle. Right, I think it's fate that I've come here. I'm just gonna go for it. Ah. It could be worse. I've got the maggots. I'd rather have the maggots than the pop-ups. Right, maggots it is then. So, a little bit disappointed, I'm not gonna lie, but no, it could be worse. Think positive, it could be worse. All out maggot assault. Hopefully we'll get a few fish and wade our way through a few doubles and nick a 20 pounder or two. Let's see. Well, here's my natural selection of baits. I've got a pot of worms here. Not sure what I'm gonna do with them. I haven't quite decided their fate just yet, so I'm gonna put them to one side for the time being. But here's the maggots, and they're in 4-pint vacuum-packed bags. They're pretty lifeless at the moment, but as soon as I open the bag, get a bit of air to them, they will start wriggling again. But that isn't what I want for this situation. I've had a few casts around with the marker, and it is quite gravelly out there, and live maggots do tend to crawl under stones and sort of be hidden from view. So I want them like this, I want them lifeless. So I'm gonna do, I'm going to tip in a gallon into the bucket. Because we have quite a strong side wind here, I'm going to add a little bit of water to them as well, just to give them a bit more weight, to the spod, so it should just cut through that side wind a lot better and hopefully improve accuracy. So yeah, I'm going to put in a gallon, which will leave me a gallon for topping up. Every time I get a bite, fingers crossed, just top up with a few more spoms, keep the fish interested. That's the plan anyway. So yeah, the marker's out there. I'm now gonna get busy with the spod and get some bait in. Won't be long till we've got rods in water, right. You know, you.
Hold on.
Oh, I tell you what.
So what are you doing now?
What am I doing, you? What am I doing?
Yeah, what are you doing now?
Serious conversation?
Well, I just want to know what you're doing.
I am about to base a rig with maggots.
Yeah? You got one tied up?
Have I got one tied up? Yep.
Okay. I'd scrap that idea. You know...
Here we go. What?
You know, so we played roulette with the bait. Just down to my left, I have three yellow bags.
Good.
Numbered 1 to 3. And they've all got different rig items in.
So what you're saying is you've just watched me tie up three rigs.
Yes.
You've just watched me tie up three rigs now. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. And?
And I didn't mention that you've got to tie up three new ones.
Was it like PVA hooklinks or something? What?
No, proper hooklinks and everything. So, pick a number.
Oh.
Look.
Here are the bags. You've just watched me attach it to the rod.
Those are the bags. Pick a number. 1, 2, or 3.
2.
Okay. Number 2, which is that one. What have you got?
Not what I want, to be honest.
Take it out.
I've just tied up 3 rigs. Don't be little hooks. That's not happening. Right, okay. Can I have another one, please?
No.
Okay, so we have some 16-pound illusion, which I like. Obviously, I don't have to use all these components, do I? I can pick which ones I use.
No. The what's in the bag has to make up your rig.
Right, 16-pound illusion, reflex camo braid in 15-pound. So I wouldn't use a braid for maggots, so it's going to be a combi rig. Zigger liner kit. I'll use the foam to balance out a maggot hook bait, like I was doing. Long shanked barbless hooks. I'm not a fan of long shank hooks, but there we go. Silicone for a little blowback rig, and tungsten sinkers to keep the hook link hole pinned down. So, yeah, that's okay. I can get a nice little rig tied with that.
You've actually done well out of that one.
Really?
There was
the hooks I'm disappointed with. I prefer a short shank bait point hook. That's just what I use, and I like a bigger hook. But hook link, yeah, nice. I can get a nice tied little combi rig out of that, so that's okay. Just the hooks, they're not my personal favourite. Come on, what was in the other ones then?
Stuff for a stiff hinge rig.
Yeah.
Which wouldn't have really been ideal with your maggot.
So basically, I've kind of almost picked out what would have been a maggot rig terminal tackle, I suppose, isn't it, really? I'm guessing.
You've actually done very well.
Have I? Right. Okay, so I'll bin them 3 rigs off. I've just tied them, eh? Well, I've already got 2 rods in position, and these are kind of the rigs I've gone for. They're all variations on a theme, using the components that Harry's provided me with. On this one, I've got the 16-pound illusion running straight through, and I've got a supple hair with a bunch of maggots and a piece of foam. But whatever rig does the biz, hopefully tonight, I'll cover in a bit more detail then. But for now, I want to get this rig out there and get the kettle on, because it's absolutely freezing.
What are you going to do about your worms?
About what?
Your worms.
My worms? I don't know. I haven't really factored them into the equation, to be honest, worms.
Well, you're supposed to. They're part of your bait package.
Well, what do you propose I do with my worms?
Well, you've got, like, I don't know, chop them up, put them in a bag or on a hair or something like that.
Chop them up?
Yes, chop worm. It's quite a popular bait, actually.
I'm not butchering worms.
Just what do you mean?
Just for your amusement.
You're trying to. This is trying to show people how to fish with naturals.
That's not happening. What? Just massacre them.
You seriously have a problem?
Yeah. I couldn't do it. I'd feel guilty.
What?
I couldn't do it.
You couldn't chop them up.
I'm more likely to set them free than to chop them up.
So
You're looking at me like a proper blank expression. You look like you've just had a lobotomy. I am probably more confident of a tree blowing down than passing the challenge.
Well, we've already seen a few trees blow down.
I'm just glad you're bivvied up right behind me, so if a tree does come down, your corpse will probably, like, soften the blow of the tree. At the moment, I would say catching anything would be a result. I'm just not feeling it.
Why?
Why? Because Baltic, that's why. I just think the rain, cold winds, I don't know. It's been pretty lifeless, so we haven't seen anything. I think to pass the challenge with 220s, I think I'm gonna need a lot of fish. I think we'll need to catch a lot of fish to try and get 220s, I think. Well, it's just about dark now, and I've seen absolutely stacks of fish showing. Only thing is, they're all down the other end of the lake. So there really is only one thing for it, and I need to move. I'm not gonna sit here tonight and blank. I've only got one night to do this challenge. And I do pick my moments. It's starting to rain now, and there's seriously black clouds coming over. I think we're in for an absolute soaking, but there's no option. We need to get moving. We need to do it quick. So let's head up down the other end of the lake. Okay, well, here we are at the other end of the lake now. We just had two casts with a marker. First pull back, found a nice patch of gravel. Cast it back out just to have a second opinion, if you like. And as I was pulling it back, I clattered into a fish. So what I'm going to do now, just wind down the line, wind down the float tight to the lead. Then I'm going to place the line in the clip on the spool, and then I'll wrap the line around the marker sticks. And however many wraps that is, I will then wrap my spod rod and all three fishing rods to that exact same distance. That way, I mean, it's going to be pitch black in the next 5 minutes. So that way, I know I can bait up. There's actually a fish just caught the line. So, there's a fish just gone into the line. He's off. Yeah, there's a few down here. That's kind of ruined my... That's kind of rude. I didn't even got it in the clip. I f***ed that up, hasn't it? That's a shame. But, as I was saying, had I have got it in the clip before that, I guess it must be a fish towing line around to just kind of move my float out of position. But that way, even now where it's pitch black, it means I can get all the bait and all three rods fishing on the exact same spot, even fishing in the dark. I managed to line the float up when I could see it in line with a tree on the far bank. So I just know that, you know, cast all three rods to that same spot, same distance, and it should be all bang on the money. But it looks like that move has paid off. It's probably only been about 20 minutes since I spotted out half a gallon of maggots. And I'm playing something. I think it's a carp. This is when I wish I had my favourite pattern of up on, but if we land this, I'm sure it'll restore my faith in long-shanked, straight-point barber's hooks. catch that.
Yes! Oh.
That's a relief. I don't think it's a 20 pounder, but it's a really encouraging start. Like I say, it's only been 20 minutes since we put a bit of bait out there. I've already got one in the bag. It's not a 20 pounder, but he isn't a million miles away, I don't think. I've zeroed the sling already. Right, scores on the doors. $17.12. So not a 20, but you can't be disappointed with that, can you? So here we are, that move definitely paid off. Less than half an hour after moving in the rain, in the dark, £17.12. Not quite the 20 we need, one of the 20s we need to pass the challenge, but a great fish to kick things off with, no doubt about that. But I'm still 220 short of a pass, so I want to slip this fella back and get a rig back on that productive spot. And I think it's time for dinner. Here we are again. This is the rod that's been in the water 10 minutes after that recast, that 17 pounder. Now it's got me wondering whether it is the rig. This is a slightly different rig to the other two I'm fishing, but a lot of the fish I've seen have been to my left, so whether it's because it's the closest rod to where I've seen the fish activity, I don't know, but I'm inclined to think it may be the rig, because I've baited one very tight area and the three rods, the distance between all three rods I would say is less than 12 feet. So to get two pickups on the same rod, I certainly don't think the carp aren't venturing sort of 3 or 4 feet one way to, you know, and only feeding on the outside edge of the bait spot. I think that's unlikely. I mean, one thing that is clear, which there is no doubt, is that move has been key. I spent, the rods are in the water for probably four or five hours in the other swim. And we've moved. And obviously the rods have been in here now less than 3/4 an hour. It's a pretty fish. Whee! Well, here we are, not quite as big as the first fish, but I mean, who'd be disappointed with this? Look at that, absolute stunner. It was only 10 minutes after that recast as well, so there's obviously quite a few fish in the area. And although we haven't had a 20 yet, it's been really enjoyable actually. I have enjoyed myself, but I am a bit hungry. Jesus. Well, it's 11 o'clock. Here's fish number three. Just polished off the barbecue. Just a shame this one hasn't had a few more burgers himself. He's a few pounds short of the 20 pound bracket, but nice looking fish all the same. I have a feeling it might be a busy night. Well, it's just gone midnight. I'd only just climbed in my sleeping bag and the rod was away again. Fish number four, probably about 12 pounds. Smallest one I've caught so far, but I can't help feeling that every fish I catch is perhaps a step closer to catching a 20, hopefully. It's just after 2 o'clock in the morning. I think I managed about 40 minutes kip before the rod rattled off again. When I was playing it, I was kind of convinced I'd had a 20. But this one's just over 18 pound. So they're getting bigger. I'm still wading through them.
But I'm half tired. I wouldn't mind getting my head down for a bit. It's 4:15, and here's carp number 6 of the night. He's an absolute belter. And they're getting bigger as well. This one's an ounce under 19 pound. So, step in the right direction. But I'm dead on my feet, to be honest. I'm absolutely knackered. I wouldn't mind having a couple of hours kip at least.
Well, good morning. It's just after 7:30, and here's carp number 7. He's no 20 pounder, but he's just over 18, this one. And I am beginning to think that this challenge is a little bit out of reach. We need 2 20 pounders, don't forget, and we have to be gone just after midday. So it is looking like a very tall ask.
Not mental.
Not really.
Such a snob, Harry. No, don't put that barbecue in me, bivvy. It'll burn the ground sheet. Just chill out.
That's like the best biscuit ever, innit? When you didn't know you had it, and you find it like an opened packet that's been there like a month. I don't know, it's like a lucky dip what we've done with these baits, but like a good lucky dip. The best bit is like the acquired tastes from all of the food items in the bag. It's not just a biscuit, it's like a meal in itself. I'm actually getting chili con carne more than chocolate. Result?
Well, yeah, because I kind of rank my session, not on the number of fish I catch, but on how high the pyramid of tea bags is next to me cup. So judging from that, you could say the session's been a complete failure. Ideally, your teabag pile should be higher than your kettle. As ours was coming on nicely, until someone scattered them everywhere. I'll tell you what would be carpy, if we reuse some of them teabags that are in that pile. I'll try it with yours, you see how it tastes, and if it tastes good, I'll do it with mine. See, I could actually see myself as being a bit of a forager if I didn't have tea. Like that Ray Mears. I just have all sorts of crap going on. I'd have nettles and grass tea and, I don't know, berry tea. I can see myself like that. I could forage. What, Bear Grylls?
Yeah. Who do you prefer?
Oh, Ray Mears.
Yeah?
Bear Grylls, he's all... No, I'm not into that. Any opportunity he can, any opportunity, he's always got his balls out, hasn't he? He's always got it out. Any opportunity. I've just fell in a river, I need to dry off, cock out. He does it every time, doesn't he?
He does, doesn't he? We need to go down this cliff. Let me take my pants off. He does it, doesn't he? Look at me spout dribbling everywhere. Well, this was the rig that I had the first two fish on, and consequently I changed all three rods over to this setup. It's primarily constructed from the 16-pound Transkharki Illusion, about 7 inches long. Then I've got one of the tungsten hook link sinkers around midway, just to keep it absolutely nailed down to the lake bed. Then come down to a size 6 LSB hook, long shank barbless hook. And because these hooks do have an in-turned eye, what I've done, I've incorporated the zigger liners that was in the pack. I've trimmed down one of the sleeves, trimmed down the loop where the foam was sitting, cut that off and slid it over the eye of the hook. And what that's done is increased the gape, because we're using the fairly stiff fluorocarbon hook link and an in-turned eye that would narrow the gape. So by using the sleeve there, it increases that gape and improves the hooking potential of the rig. Now, I had some 15-pound reflex braid to use as well. So I've decided to use that to create a supple hair. Now, what I did with the hair section is tied it like a knotless knot, whipped down the shank about 10 turns, and then to attach the stiffer section, did another knotless knot setup and whips over the supple section. So that's attached nicely. We come down from that, we have a small piece of the fine silicon just to trap the hair in place there. And if you're coming down again, you see there's a piece of red foam that's also from the zigger liner pack there. And that not only balances the hook bait out, but it also aids to create some separation, and that prevents the maggots from crawling around and becoming impaled on the hook point, which will obviously really hinder the hooking potential of the rig. And then I've threaded about 15-16 maggots onto a piece of fine mono, just with a sewing needle, and then just threaded them through the loop on the hair and tied them on. And that's the rig that's done the biz. Now, to start with, I was perhaps a little apprehensive when I pulled out these long shanks, barbless straight point hooks. From past experience, I've not found them to be the best pattern to use in a barbless. I've much preferred to use a short shank, beaked point barbless hook, as I believe that once they go in, they tend to stay in a lot better. But I've had 7 bites on this setup and landed all 7 fish, so it's certainly gone some way to restoring my faith in the long shank straight point barbless pattern. It's been a couple of hours now since we caught that 18-pound common, and I'm not really feeling it now, if I'm honest. Most of the fish, barring that last fish, all came during the hours of darkness. And Phil and John, the fishery bailiffs, they've both said that it has mainly been nighttime bites. And to top it off, there's now 5 coots diving down over the baited spot. And I think if there was any fish down there feeding, I think them birds would be a lot more hesitant about diving down if there's a group of carp below them. So I think the chances of catching anything before it's time to call it a day in the next couple of hours, let alone a 20-pounder or 2 20-pounders, are pretty much diminishing by the second.
What happened to the worms?
What happened to the worms?
Yeah, you're supposed to use them.
I don't know where they are. I don't know if you had them.
No, you're supposed to use them. Have you set them free?
No. I don't know where they are. They'll be around here somewhere. They can't have gone far, they haven't got any legs. No. I don't know where they've gone, mate.
You set them free.
I haven't. That Moran had his eye on him. Blame him. Stop following me around, making me look guiltier than I am. Well, make him look guilty.
Go on. Off you go. Well, you're gonna have to move a bit faster than that, lads. Jesus.
Well, that's it. My time is up. It seems as though night time was very much bite time. Just had that one fish during daylight hours, and that really was at first light. So I haven't even managed to catch another fish, let alone the 220s needed to pass the challenge. So sorry about that, Daniel. But, you know, it was a bit of a roulette. If I'd have picked another bucket with the pop-ups in, you know, I probably would have caught fewer fish, but they might have been of a better stamp. Same with the boilies, an all-out boilie approach. I'm sure it would have caught fewer fish than what we caught with the maggots. But again, you know, they could have been of a better average size. It's all ifs and buts, you know. I mean, if my auntie had testicles, she'd be my uncle, wouldn't she? So, but although it's a fail, I am not leaving here anyway downbeat. When I've failed these in the past, I've been really glum and miserable, but I've had an absolutely awesome night's fishing. 7 fish, average have been upper doubles, really. So I'm not going to leave here unhappy at all. I've really enjoyed this session. So it's a fail on paper, but in my head, it's sort of a pass. So yeah, a little bit tired after being awake all night, and I've now got a 4-hour drive back home. So hopefully I'll make it back in one piece, and I'll see you next time. If you'd like to watch more of my challenge videos, then click the link here. Or if you'd like to subscribe to Fox Fishing TV, then click the link here.
That was good.